Good evening and welcome to St. George Church for the celebration of the third Sunday in Ordinary Time. The celebrant for today is Father Tom, assisted by Deacon Jerry. Mass is being celebrated for the intentions of Joseph Kiley, Judy Ruck, and Marguerite Altenbach. This week at St. George, the St. George School Strike at Rich raffle tickets are now available. The grand prize is $10,000. Tickets can be purchased through a school family or at the school or rectory office. This weekend, there is a second collection for the church in Latin America. Thank you for your continued generosity. On the Sea of Galilee, Simon and Andrew were fishing for fish when Jesus walked past, saying, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men," changing their lives forever. We hear stories of calls in the readings today, calls to follow, calls of conversion, calls to repentance, calls to discipleship. Let us take this opportunity today to listen closely and discern whether we can hear Jesus calling us to something more. We greet one another in the Lord. Please stand and wave friendly greetings to those around you.
Sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you are the eternal Son of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, who shows the way to repentance. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the way to eternal life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Of your beloved Son, we may abound in good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, saying, "Set out for the great city of Nineveh, and announce to it the message that I will tell you." So Jonah made ready and went to Nineveh, according to the Lord's bidding. Now Nineveh was an enormously large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began his journey through the city, and had gone but a single day's walk, announcing, 40 days more and Nineveh shall be destroyed." When the people of Nineveh believed God, they proclaimed a fast, and all of them, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw by their actions how they turned from their evil way, he repented on the evil that he had threatened to do to them. He did not carry it out. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. After Jesus had been arrested, after John had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. And then Jesus passed by the Sea of Galilee. He saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting their nets into the sea. They were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." Then they abandoned their nets and followed him. And he walked along a little further, and he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They too were in a boat, mending their nets. And he called them. And so they left their father Zebedee in the boat, along with the hired men, and followed him. Sisters and brothers, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus
Christ. So I have a question for you. How many of you have that habit of counting down the days until Christmas? Show your hands. Come on. Okay. How many of you have that habit of counting the days until Ash Wednesday and Lent? Okay. So today when you go home, take out a piece of paper, write down in big black bold numbers 25, put it on the refrigerator. We have 25 days until Ash Wednesday and Lent. And as that is just around the corner, I want to focus today on Jonah to understand what we heard this morning in Jonah chapter 3. We have to first visit chapters 1 and 2. Now in chapter 4, Jonah gets angry at God. That's a homily for another day, giving us permission to be angry at God. But I also hope that sometime before Lent and Ash Wednesday, you'll sit down and meditatively read through Jonah and pray over it. So let's begin our journey today. God calls to Jonah to take a message of to repentance to Nineveh, the capital of Assyria. At this time, Assyria was a very formidable power in the ancient Near East. They had conquered the Jewish kingdoms of Israel and Judah. They were feared for their abuse of power and their oppression. They took up residence in the Jewish lands. They moved in, married the Jewish people, mixed marriages. They worshipped idols. So Jonah had this deep-seated hatred, resentment, and anger toward the Assyrians. So now when God calls him and says, "Hey, I want you to go to those folks and preach a message of repentance," Jonah goes, "Do we have a wrong connection, God? You got to be kidding me. You want me to go to those people? Forget it, God." And Jonah boogies the other way. He gets on a boat. And before you know it, a storm comes up. The boat's about ready to capsize. The seafarers on the boat are frightened, and they wonder what brought on this storm. It was Jonah. Jonah did not listen to God. And he begged those seafarers. He said, "Throw me overboard." Well, they prayed to their gods first before they did that. Then in throwing Jonah overboard, they would not be punished. They threw him overboard. And then God sent a great fish to swallow Jonah, often depicted in pictures and children's books as a great big whale. He swallowed Jonah. For 3 days, Jonah was there in the belly of the whale, and he gave this beautiful, fervent prayer you read in Jonah 2. But I wonder, how many of us, if we found ourselves in the belly of a whale for 3 days, would offer fervent prayers? Think about that. What a prayer closet that would be. And then we finally come to today's lesson. It says the great fish vomited Jonah onto the seashore. He's on dry land. And now, for a second time, the Lord God comes to Jonah and says, hey, go to Nineveh, preach this message of repentance, or else suffer the consequences. So the first lesson that comes to us today is this. How often do we listen to the Lord God and do what the Lord God tells us to do? This God of second chances. Remember that parable Jesus told about the two sons? The one said, I'll go work in the vineyard, and he took off. The other said, no, but then he changed his mind. The God of second chances. Many, many years ago, when I was studying ministry for the Presbyterian Church, I saw this beautiful poster of Jonah who had just been spit upon the seashore. And I'd love to replicate this because I think it would be a picture that we should put on our refrigerators during Lent. But you look at the picture in the left-hand corner, there's the whale with a smirk on his face. And there's Jonah standing there with this horrific look. Head to toe, he's dressed in whale phlegm and seaweed. And the caption simply read, listen to God. Listen to God. But since seeing that poster over 40 years ago, I've had to ask myself, how many times over the years have I not listened to God and been spiritually draped with whale phlegm and seaweed? And how many times did God give me that second chance? Listening to God. That is how we respond to our call to be Jesus' disciples in the world. Hans Walter Wolff shares that we are called as Jesus' disciples to Nineveh, and that this is what it means for us today to be called to Nineveh, to go to Nineveh. And what that means for us is to let the great needs and instances of evil in the world completely determine the direction of our efforts and our life work. The message about Jesus Christ becomes privatized and diminished if we don't pay attention to what is happening in Damascus, Moscow, Washington, Asia, Africa, Berlin, and London. Or if we don't see our human failure to care for the least of these, for the sick and the old. Or if we don't see our human failure in the work of education at home and in developing countries abroad. Or the monstrous dangers that are connected with manipulating human beings through drugs and the lack of genuine care of souls. But Jonah is not supposed to go to the whole world. Go to Nineveh. Go to that one place that God has opened your eyes to see. Risk your life. Prepare yourself to do that which the Lord commands. So Jonah teaches us about faithfulness, about being Jesus' disciples each and every day. He teaches us to listen to God and to do as God wants us to do as his disciples. And so you're invited to prayerfully ask yourself, where is the Nineveh that God is calling me to? Where is the Nineveh that God is calling me to? The other lesson we learn today is the depths of God's mercy. God's mercy is evident first in sparing those sailors from perishing on the high sea. God's mercy is evident in giving Jonah a second chance to go and be God's faithful disciple, to preach that message of repentance to Nineveh. God's mercy is evident in the people of Nineveh, who upon hearing that message believed God, proclaimed a fast, and put on sackcloth. God's mercy is evident in the king of Nineveh, who proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth. And God's mercy is evident in God's repentance, God's change of mind not to render evil on Nineveh. Think about that for a moment. That God rendered mercy on himself and God changed his mind, God repented. What does that teach us about the sacrament of reconciliation and confession? That God repented. But for a moment, Remember how God has woven the threads of mercy throughout your whole life. Yes, there are 25 days until Ash Wednesday in Lent. And so I want to leave you with these thoughts and questions for your own meditation and prayer. The first is this. Give yourself a spiritual hearing test. How well have you listened to God? How then did you faithfully act on what God asked you to do as His disciple? And then consider the threads of God's mercy that He has woven throughout your life. And ask yourself, has the Word of God, has my participation in the Eucharist ever brought me to immediate repentance? But what place does repentance play in my own life? In my life in Christ? Is repentance something I feel a great need for? As I think about that question, I think about those people who say, I don't need to go to confession. I can go in the woods and talk to God. But how many of us have not been to confession in over a month? What place does repentance place in your own faith, your life in Christ? Is it something you feel a great need for? And finally, this question. What kind of change or conversion needs to happen daily in your own life? What kind of change or conversion needs to happen daily in your own life?
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible.
For the church, that we will ever be more fervent in proclaiming the kingdom of God and the truth of the gospel, we pray to the Lord. Then in a world torn by strife, God's people may shine forth as a prophetic sign of unity and concord. We pray to the Lord. For the grace to be repentant and to believe ever more firmly in the fulfillment Christ offers, we pray to the Lord. That the Holy Spirit may move our hearts to seek unity and solidarity with the faithful throughout Latin America and the Caribbean by sharing our material and spiritual goods, we pray to the Lord. For those who experience anguish or sorrow in their lives, that the Lord will relieve their burdens and give them joy, we pray to the Lord. For the faithful departed, especially those from our own families and parish community, that they may rise with Christ and enjoy eternal rest. And so we remember Ann Herbach, Antoinette Scardina, Russ Lovey, and Joan Stanley. We pray to the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Pray, brother, that my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God, Almighty Father. Accept our offerings, O Lord, we pray, and in sanctifying them, grant that they may profit us for salvation, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is true, right, and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder to rule in your name over all you have made and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And so with all the angels we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the bread, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered in the one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Blaise our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of thy Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
The Savior's command, and formed by thy teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and glory are yours
now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I give you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us share with one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And now go in peace to love and to serve the Lord by your witness and by your life.
Thanks.